Welcome to Chubb Global Insight. I'm Edward Le. Today, my guest is Bilahari Kausikan, a Singapore academic, retired diplomat, and civil servant. Bilahari, your 37-year career with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs encompasses a wide variety of appointments. You were formerly the permanent representative to the United Nations, ambassador at large, ambassador to the Russian Federation, and permanent secretary. You are the chairman of the Middle East Institute, an autonomous institute from the National University of Singapore. Welcome to this conversation.
Nice to see you again.
Now, I'd like to ask the first question about Singapore and about Singapore's status as a financial hub. Can it sustain its status?
Look, I don't think we should find anything unusual with competition. Competition is a natural state of affairs, and competition is global. It's Hong Kong, it's Shanghai, it's Tokyo, it's Dubai, it's London, it's Frankfurt, it's New York, it's everywhere. And that's a normal condition. We're used to it. We have certain advantages. The financial industry is one which I would call an industry that values the trust quotient very highly. Now, Singapore's comparative advantage, unique advantage in our part of the world, I think, is the trust that the government has instilled in both business and its own people. This is a strong government, a stable government, an honest government, an effective government, a predictable government, and a consistent one, which provides a very business-friendly environment. Singapore is a safe haven for capital, for the talent that works the capital, and for the intellectual property that is embedded in the financial industry. So I don't see why we shouldn't be able to continue to prosper and thrive as a financial center, provided we are alert and agile.
Not too long ago, Singapore celebrated its 50th year of independence. How can Singapore stay relevant in the post-COVID world?
Well, you know, we are projecting now 5.8% growth for this year, 2021. Which will bring us back to where we started before the pandemic. But it won't be quite the same economy. The recovery is not going to be even over all sectors. The sectors that are connected to international travel, whether it is tourism or whether it is conferences and things like that, that will take quite some time to recover. And that's a fact for everybody, I think. However, there are other parts that I think will bounce back quite quickly. If we look at what has happened in China, Taiwan, but possibly our export sector will bounce back first. There will be new opportunities as digitalization is accelerated. So I think it's going to be a long road ahead for everybody, including Singapore, but we'll make it.
As an overseas business, should I be investing more in Singapore?
Well, I think so, but then I'm Singaporean, so you must take my advice with a pinch of salt. Because I'm not exactly objective. It really depends on the kind of business you are in. If you are the kind of business that depends on low labor costs and so on, obviously Singapore is not the place for you. But if you are in a business that puts a premium on quality, puts a premium on safety, trust in the regulatory environment, the predictability of the regulatory environment, if you are in a business that needs a very high quality labor force at the high end of the value chain, then I think you have to be in Singapore. And I think most international businesses have some kind of presence in Singapore. I'm hard-pressed to think of any major business name that isn't here in some way.
I've recently read your book, Dealing with an Ambiguous World. It's clear that political and economic power in Southeast Asia continue to shift and evolve alongside emergence of new markets and an appetite for product services and investments. Which sectors and countries do you expect to thrive in the coming years?
Well, Southeast Asia as a whole is certainly one of the dynamic growth areas within a dynamic larger region of Asia. It's driven by a number of factors. We can discuss that later, perhaps. Now, I think you have to focus on a number of countries, irrespective of which sectors you are in. Indonesia, of course, Vietnam, I'll put that in the first tier. Thailand, Philippines, Malaysia in the second tier. Singapore is kind of sui generis because we are a city-state, much more developed than the rest of the region. And we are probably a good place to put your R&D, your headquarters, your financial services for the whole region.
You've spoken a lot about Association of Southeast Asian Nations, ASEAN. How successful has ASEAN been in promoting economic, social, cultural development, as well as peace and security in Southeast Asia?
I think let's be clear, there is no kind of development of any kind without peace and security as the foundation. And ASEAN has been extremely successful in that respect. I think you're probably too young, Edward, but if you can remember what Southeast Asia was like prior to 1964, when ASEAN was founded, well, the region was a mess. Think of it this way. Singapore had just been expelled from Malaysia and the relationship was extremely fraught with racial tension. Indonesia had just stopped fighting an undeclared war against Malaysia and after we separated against Singapore as well. The Philippines had claimed a large section of Malaysia to wit Sabah. And in Indochina, there was a hot war raging. There was no reason to believe that this region would develop as it has developed. And I think ASEAN is a very large part of that. Now, mind you, I have to qualify that slightly because ASEAN is an interstate organization. Essentially, that means that it can do nothing that its members are not willing for it to do. And so it is the combination of national policy as well as regional organization that has made Southeast Asia what it is today, which is a region that is not without its problems, which region is without problems, but very largely at peace with itself, growing, and with a bright future.
Well, Bilahari, you've met many businessmen, many civil servants, different countries in Southeast Asia. In your views, do multinational business understand the opportunities that exist in Southeast Asia?
Well, I think they do, most of them, the vast majority of them, because they are already here. And if you're a multinational business that is not here for some reason, well, I suggest you move yourself over here quickly, otherwise your competition is going to eat your lunch.
Let me then focus and zoom into a particular area of opportunity. Recently, I've read about a research done by Temasek Holding that there will be about 400 million population in Southeast Asia that will thrive in the digital economy. How can the region continue to realize its full potential of digital technologies?
Well, I think it's obvious that digitalization is the future, not just in Southeast Asia, but everywhere. But Southeast Asia has certain advantages, and you have mentioned them. The mobile phone penetration in Southeast Asia is growing exponentially. Most of the systems in Southeast Asia, 4G and so on, and we are moving into 5G, are new systems, so you don't have legacy problems of getting rid of old systems. And you have a young population which is a little bit more comfortable with digitalization. At the same time, in the big economies of Southeast Asia, Philippines, Indonesia, Philippines, Vietnam, you have a very large number of people that are still unbanked. And that's an obvious opportunity for fintech. You put the two things together, you have a big opportunity. And there is a very vibrant startup culture in places like Jakarta, which is riding this wave of digitalization, of innovation. The key success factor is governance. The right kind of governance to build the right kind of regulatory regimes that will enable this and minimize the risks. There are, of course, risks, so that you can maximize the potential of the digital revolution. There is another factor. I think the youth of population in places like Indonesia and the Philippines and Vietnam is a big plus factor, but they need to be given opportunities. Otherwise, inequalities will grow. Digitalization can and promote inequalities. You need to give them the right kind of education. The weakest part of the Southeast Asian story, other than Singapore, is the educational systems in the other economies, which are extremely patchy. You need to up the game across the board better in order to maximize the advantages that are here.
Now, I'd like to continue this conversation about Southeast Asia's relationship with its neighboring countries. Let's start with China. China can't be ignored because of its size and influence. How has the Belt and Road Infrastructure Initiative launched in 2013 shaped geopolitics and geoeconomics in Southeast Asia?
China is one of the two major powers, the other being India, that is contiguous to Southeast Asia. As a big, contiguous, growing power, China will always have significant influence in Southeast Asia. But for precisely those same reasons, its contiguity, its size, its growth, it's always going to raise anxieties among the smaller countries along its periphery, including in Southeast Asia. It's not something you can ignore, but it's not something that arouses ambivalent feelings in the region. I think nobody wants to shun China. Everybody wants to benefit, to ride on its growth, but it has to be managed. The Belt and Road in Southeast Asia is potentially a very important project. I tend to think of the Belt and Road more as a collection of projects. Some work better than others. Some have been suspended. Some will have to be restructured to make them more sustainable over the long run. But it is a new factor that nobody can ignore. And on the whole, a positive factor.
Given what you just said, how should national and international businesses position themselves given China's influence in the region?
Well, what I just said was that China will always have significant influence, but China will always raise anxieties in the region. And that creates a certain ambivalence. I think it would be very foolish for any business, whether national or international, to ignore China. But it would be also equally foolish for any business, national or international, to put all their eggs in one basket. Certainly, that's the case in the field which I am most familiar with, which is diplomacy, where hedging and balancing is a natural state of affairs for countries in Southeast Asia. Southeast Asian diplomacy is never monogamous. It's always promiscuous. And though, so my advice to businesses is don't put your eggs in one basket. And they don't, you know, because look, China is a significant player. It will become an even more significant player. But United States has always been a significant player. Japan is a significant player, has always been one. South Korea is a player of growing significance. Australia is there. Europe is there. India is there. You know, this is a naturally multipolar, multidimensional region. And I think businesses, just like governments, should leverage on that.
You just mentioned about Japan. How has Japan's relationship with Singapore and Southeast Asia evolved since the 1970s?
Well, it's a much older relationship than the 1970s, you know. Japan has been, in one way or the other, engaging Southeast Asia since the late 19th century and early 20th century. It's not always been a happy relationship, but I think, by and large, all Southeast Asian countries have decided to look forward in their relations with Japan and not backwards. It is probably the ASEAN dialogue partner that understands Southeast Asia the best. In 1997, the then Japanese Prime Minister, Mr. Fukuda, announced what was called the Fukuda Doctrine. It was a very bold vision of Japan's role in creating one Southeast Asia, a united Southeast Asia. And that was a bold vision because 1977, the Cold War was still raging and it was hot. The Cold War was hot on the mainland. It was a very bold vision to think of Southeast Asia in holistic terms and to deploy your assets, both economic, diplomatic, political, as well as economic, to try to make that a reality. And that is really largely a reality today. Japan is always going to be an important actor in Southeast Asia. The fact is that Japan, many surveys have shown that Japan is the most trusted country of all ASEAN's dialogue partners by all the ASEAN countries.
You also mentioned about South Korea, another major North Asia country.
As I mentioned, I think in passing, in my answer to your earlier question, this is a naturally multipolar region. It's not just South Korea, or Japan or the United States or China, it's India, it is Australia, it is New Zealand, it is many European countries that have always been here. And that is a function of geography. This is the strategic crossroads between two major oceans, the Indian Ocean and the Pacific Ocean, and that's why we have this now this new term, the Indo-Pacific. It is the junction of many important trade routes, shipping routes, airline routes. So you're always going to have a rather complex situation in Southeast Asia, whether it's in business or diplomacy, and in that complexity, there is opportunity. Take advantage of it.
You just mentioned about the Indo-Pacific cooperation of growing economic opportunity. Share with us your views about India as an important and strategic partner to Southeast Asia.
Now, India is a huge country. In fact, it's a continent in itself. It is an extremely complex country, much more complex than, say, China, which is a country of comparable size in terms of population. So most of India's energy, whether it's economic, diplomatic, strategic, is going to be more inwardly focused than outwardly focused. But India is what I would call an existential geopolitical power, that by its very existence, by its very size and its existence, it cannot be ignored. It plays a role, whether it's passive or active, whether its policies are successful or less successful, India cannot be ignored. It is there. It is a geopolitical fact, an existential geopolitical fact. Of recent years, India is beginning to look east, to act east, and that is to be welcome, I think. But it will be slow. It will move at its own pace, but it's not something that can ever be ignored.
Let's continue our conversation about Southeast Asia's relationship with the West. My first question on that would be, has China's growing influence diminished the role of the US and its investment?
No, not at all. You know, as I said, China evokes ambivalent feelings, great sense of opportunity, but some sense of anxiety as well. And that, I think, has led to a greater appreciation of the vital and irreplaceable role of the United States in maintaining stability in this entire region, not just Southeast Asia, but the region that we now call the Indo-Pacific, which stretches from the Persian Gulf to Northeast Asia. China is a growing economic influence, a growing economic partner, but that has not at all diminished the role of the US. I don't know whether you know this, but the stock of US investment in Southeast Asia is greater than that of China, Japan, and South Korea combined. And it's likely to remain so for quite some time to come. So it's a vital power. It's an irreplaceable power. And that is more widely recognized today than it was, let's say, 10 or 20 years ago.
How do you see US foreign policy towards Singapore and Southeast Asia under President Biden?
Look, you know, I think Mr. Trump was a disruptive factor, but I think we should not exaggerate that. US policy in this part of the world, not just Southeast Asia, but as I said, you know, from Northeast Asia down through Southeast Asia, there has been as much continuity as there has been change. I see Mr. Biden pursuing much the same policies as Mr. Trump in his goals. However, in a much more orderly, less disruptive, more orthodox way. And that's, of course, to be welcome. In a more consultative way with friends, partners, and allies. And that's, of course, to be welcome. But it's not a rough shift away as far as his goals are concerned. It's a much more orderly implementation of things that Trump said were his goals, but did not really implement in a very coherent manner. As far as the bilateral relationship between Singapore and the United States is concerned, it's a very stable relationship. It has endured through many administrations of both parties because it's a relationship based on common interests, common strategic outlook, and a great deal of institutional relationships between different institutions. It transcends the vagaries of American domestic politics because it's based in institutions.
How does Singapore and Southeast Asia nations view Europe and European Union after the exit of United Kingdom?
Well, I think the exit of the United Kingdom is not a big factor on how we look at Europe. You know, Europe is another geopolitical fact. but it's a rather abstract one. Like if I just take Singapore as an example, right? When we think of Europe, or when we say Europe in economic terms, for example, we really mean four countries, now three. And the four are, in order of importance, Germany, France, Netherlands, and when Britain was part of Europe, Britain. The rest of Europe is there, of course, but they are not very significant trading partners. Europe is much more seen as an economic actor, although some European countries are beginning to act strategically in this region. France always has. Britain is going to send an aircraft carrier through this region. Germany has said that it intends to send a frigate through Southeast Asia. But Europe is, in global terms, another geopolitical fact that nobody can ignore. Singapore has a free trade agreement with Europe, and we do that because it's an important economic actor. It sets standards that nobody can ignore. And that's so with or without Britain.
Now, what do you think about the notion that London could be Singapore on the Thames?
It's a nice slogan, but I don't take it very seriously. The structure of our economy, the structure of our society, the nature of our politics and governance is so different that it's a nice slogan.
As I've stated during my introduction, you were an ambassador to the Russian Federation. How has Russia changed since those years?
Well, those were very, very difficult years for the Russians and the Russian people. This were the immediate post-Soviet years. Yeltsin was president. And the Russian people went through real hardship. And the reason they went through real hardship was a very simple one and a very puzzling one to me to this day. Some people in the West convinced the Russians or their leaders at that time that shock therapy was needed to change a 70-year-old planned economic system overnight into a market economy. This is the most ridiculous idea I've ever heard. Only a theoretical economist could have thought of it. How can you change a 70-year-old system into a functioning market economy within 500 days? But the Russians didn't know better. They trusted the West. They listened to this stupid advice. And there was real hardship, even hunger in Moscow, the heart of the Russian capital. At the same time, during those years, the West made some fundamental political mistakes in dealing with Russia. Promises made as the Soviet Union went down and Germany was reunited were not kept. And the most important of those was not to expand NATO eastwards beyond Germany's eastward border. That would have been threatening to any kind of Russian government, and it was. I think it led to a certain disillusionment with the West by the vast majority of the Russian political elite and indeed of the Russian people. It's a mistake for the West to think that those who want Russia to be like the West, who admire the West, are the majority. They are not. Mr. Putin understands this very well, and therefore he's still in power and you will have to deal with him.
Given the shortcomings you mentioned, how should the West today manage its relations with Russia?
Well, deal with Russia as it is. It's a big country in population. It is a permanent member of the Security Council of the UN. It is a nuclear weapon state. That's, in other words, it's an unavoidable geopolitical fact that has to be dealt with as it is, not as you hope or wish it will be. This is a fact. Deal with it.
You were formerly the permanent representative to the United Nations. Is the United Nations fit for purpose in the modern day?
Look, you know, the United Nations has never worked exactly as its founders intended it to work, not from day one. On the other hand, are we better off with a United Nations, imperfect as it may be, or if there's no United Nations? I think the answer to me anyway is obvious. We're better off with even an imperfect United Nations than no United Nations. And also don't forget that the UN is an interstate organization and can therefore do no more than its members, in particular its most powerful members, allow it to do. It is not an autonomous actor in international relations. So the UN is often a very convenient alibi for major powers, both East and West, China, Russia, all the five permanent members have used the United Nations as an alibi for things that they didn't want to do had no intention of doing in the first place.
Bilahari, thank you so much for joining us today at Chubb Global Insights.
Oh, my pleasure, Edward. I enjoyed it and I hope to see you in person when travel is again possible.
Thank you. See you soon.